Hey guys. Okay, so if you saw the Lucky Socks post that I put up on social media earlier this week, you would know that on Tuesday, I did a presentation to a group of industry professionals, a presentation that focused on pre-1911 dwellings. The feedback that I actually received from that presentation was really, really positive. So I thought, hey, why don't I use this week's video to deep dive into part of that presentation? So today we're going to focus on what are the 15 key signs that I personally use to help me work out whether a house is pre or post 1911. Now, I hate to do this, but I've got to put a disclaimer out there. I'm not a heritage expert. I'm a town planner. I've had the great fortune, let's just say, to be exposed to some amazing heritage mentors over the years, but that does not make me an expert in this field. So I'd like you to take what I'm going to say today as kind of like a starting point for your own investigations. Do not take what I'm about to say as gospel. As we always say in our outro for our videos, you would be a silly billy to go and make financial decisions based on the advice provided in these videos, so don't be a silly billy. You'd think after 2 years that outro would get old. It still makes me laugh. If you don't know what I'm talking about, make sure you stay to the very end of the video. It's a cracker. Oh, like I said, it still makes me laugh to this day. Anyway, let's move on. The next point I want to make before we launch into these 15 signs is, unlike the 1946 cutoff, 1911 does not represent a clear point in time. So 1946, we just finished the war. We're experiencing major changes in terms of our economy, our access to materials, our housing needs, all of that sort of stuff. So it's relatively easy to work out whether a house is pre or post 1947, 1946, depends how you want to describe it. 1911, unfortunately, does not represent a clear marker in time, a clear shift in the way we did things. So it makes it a lot harder to work out whether a house is pre or post 1911. So you just need to keep that in mind. Now, the next thing I want to say is you can't look at one of these identifiers or one of these tips or what am I trying to say here? Let's just stick with tips. You can't use one of these things to sit there and go, oh, it's pre-1911. It doesn't work like that. If it's just one thing, it's probably not pre-1911. But if you find three, four, hey, even five different things, then you can sit there and go, okay, it's most likely pre-1911. So now that we've got that out of the way, we've set the scene, let's dive into the 15 things. First and foremost, you need to remember back in the day, our housing demands or needs were very, very different. We weren't the wealthy, rich mother country. We were the convict settlement. So as a result, we didn't have these big, fancy schmancy houses. Everyone was squished in. I mean, these days, every kid has a bedroom and an ensuite attached to the bedroom. Back then, everyone just crammed in. So if you turn up and you see a house and you look at it and go, okay, the original portion of that house is really, really tiny. I'm talking like one bedroom, maybe two bedrooms deep, then that's a sign that it could be pre-1911. However, if you turn up and you see a kind of big house with three or four bedrooms deep, okay, well, that's probably not going to be pre-1911. Next, what I like to call A-frame or M-shaped roofs. So I'm talking the super steep roof, if I get my words out, roof pitches that form like an A or an M sort of shape. If you see those, not only are they pre-1911, more often than not, they're pre-1900. They are really, really old. Okay, I don't actually know what the technical term for this roof form is, but I describe it as a single sheet roof form. So the roof runs from the ridge right down to the veranda edge in a single sheet, and it looks like someone's come along and chopped the edges of the house off to be able to squeeze it into the block. So if you see that roof form, again, pre-1911 alarm bells going off. Next, this is what's called commonly a bastard roof. So if you're driving down the street, to just the passing eye, it would look like a single sheet. Hopefully this captures in the web camera, a single sheet. If it's a bastard roof, that single sheet has a slight kick in it. So if you look at what was previously the veranda, you'll see that there's a slight change in roof pitch. That is very typically pre-1911, if not pre-1900. Okay, next, if you see a detached veranda roof that has a curve in it, so a convex roof or a bullnose roof, that's a sign of pre-1911. I'm going to sound like a bit of a broken record here. Pre-1911, you'll get used to it. Okay, so just to go against what we're talking about there, if you turn up and you see a house that has more than one gable, then it's most likely not going to be pre-1911. I'm yet to see a pre-1911 house that has more than one gable on it. So that's another way you can sort of do the reverse analysis, let's just say. Double hung windows. Oh, I love double hung windows. So I'm talking about the windows where you lift the bottom pane up and it overlaps with the top pane. That is so pre-1911. Now, front doors. If you turn up and you see four panels to the front door, that should be an identifier, an alarm bell to you to go, ooh, could this house be pre-1911? Horizontal internal boards. So we're very, very used to turning up to Queenslanders and seeing the vertical boards. So the boards that run from top to bottom. But if you turn up and you see boards that are running sideways, that should be a trigger for you to go, ooh, could this house be pre-1911? Now, in this image here, this is actually a house near me. The front facade has been reclad. So you can see the front facade has narrow boards. I'm talking maybe 5-10 centimeters in height, whereas the side facade has original boards, which are maybe 15 or 20 centimeters in height. So like I said, the side is the original portion of the house. The front has been reclad. Those wider boards scream pre-1911 to me. Balustrading. Okay, so if you turn up and you see the cross brace, or if you see wrought iron, oh, wrought iron is so, so beautiful. I have a soft spot for wrought iron houses. Anyway, Union Jack or two rail dowel. Again, they're all pre-1911 characteristics. Now, just a little side tip there with the two rail. If you turn up, don't automatically assume that it's pre-1911. Get really, really close and have a look at how the dowel is actually threaded through that bottom, or how it's connected to that bottom rail. If it's threaded through, then that's a sign of pre-1911. However, if it's just tacked onto the top and tacked onto the bottom, so it's either glued or nailed to the top and glued to the, or nailed to the bottom, then that's kind of a sign of a replica. See, back in the day, they took the time to cut the hole out and thread the pole through. These days we cut corners and we don't do that. So yeah, don't just see the two rail and go, oh, it's pre-1911. Get up really close and see how it's actually been built. 13, we're almost to the end now. If you turn up and you see really, really wide staircase, I'm talking like 2 meters, 3 meters wide, or if you turn up and you see a split staircase, oh, pre-1911, baby. Oh, I love those staircases. We don't do them like that these days because we don't have the space, but back then they had the space. Now, number 14, I'm yet to see a yet to see a post-1911 house that has a chimney. Replica chimneys, okay, every now and then they pop up, but original chimneys are so, so pre-1911. They're so cute. I remember as a kid sitting next to the chimney and next to the, sorry, the fireplace, warming myself up. Oh, it was so beautiful. Anyway, number 15, lucky last. If you turn up and you see some really unique detailing, some fancy schmancy detailing, I'm talking some extra colored light, lead light panels in the windows, or fancy little architraves or things like that, that should be an alarm bell to go, ooh, this could be pre-1911. Because back then they had time to spend on that fancy stuff. These days we're all about the efficiency and we don't do that level of detail. So, as I suggested in the beginning, you don't need to turn up and just, or you can't turn up and just look for one of these things. It's kind of like a bingo game. You got to turn up and look for 3, 4, or heck, even 5 of these things. If you get that number, you can go, bingo, it's pre-1911. Generally speaking, again, I go back to the disclaimer at the beginning. You can't always bank on this, but it gives you a good starting point. Now, the final thing I wanted to say is I'm going to link some additional resources in the comments below. So some previous videos that we've recorded that give you a bit more insight into the why behind all of these requirements, a bit of a history lesson. I'm also going to link in some resources that tell you how to actually take this investigation process further. So if you sit there and you think, okay, based on these tips, I've got a pre-1911 house, then how to actually verify that using things like postal records, electoral records, all of that fun sort of stuff. So I think that covers everything that I wanted to talk about today. As I always say, until next time, thanks for watching.
For all you red tape lovers out there, I have one thing to say. Well, no, actually, I've got three. Number one, the advice provided in these videos is general in nature. It's not site specific. You would be a silly billy to go and make financial decisions based on this advice without first checking with the town planner. Don't be a silly billy. Number two, Brisbane Town Planning is in no way linked to Brisbane City Council. The views expressed in these videos are my own, not Council's. So if you don't like them, blame me, not Council. Number three, what was my number three? Oh yeah, the views expressed in these videos are accurate at the time of recording. If you're watching this video back 10 years from now, the views may not be so accurate. That's all.